Simon & Schuster Audio presents Just After Sunset, Stories by Stephen King. With an introduction and endnotes read by the author, and stories read by Jill Eikenberry, Holter Graham, George Guidall, Stephen King, Ron McLarty, Denis O'Hare, Ben Shenkman, Skipp Sudduth, Mare Winningham, and Karen Ziemba.
I can fancy what you saw. Yes, it is horrible enough, but after all, it is an old story, an old mystery play. Such forces cannot be named, cannot be spoken, cannot be imagined except under a veil and a symbol. A symbol to the most of us appearing a quaint poetic fancy, to some a foolish tale. But you and I, at all events, have known something of the terror that may dwell in the secret place of life, manifested under human flesh, that which is without form, taking to itself a form. Oh, Austin, how can it be? How is it that the very sunlight does not turn to blackness before this thing, the hard earth melt and boil beneath such a burden? Arthur Machen, The Great God Pan. Hi, this is Steve King. One day in 1972, I came home from work and found my wife sitting at the kitchen table with a pair of gardening shears in front of her. She was smiling, which suggested I wasn't in too much trouble. On the other hand, she said she wanted my wallet. That didn't sound good. Nevertheless, I handed it over. She rummaged out my Texaco gasoline credit card, such things were routinely sent to young marrieds then, and proceeded to cut it into three large pieces. When I protested that the card had been very handy, and we always made at least the minimum payment at the end of the month, sometimes more, she only shook her head and told me that the interest charges were more than our fragile household economy could bear. Better to remove the temptation, she said. I already cut up mine. And that was that. Neither of us carried a credit card for the next 2 years. She was right to do it, smart to do it, because at the time, we were in our early 20s and had two kids to take care of. Financially, we were just keeping our heads above water. I was teaching high school English and working at an industrial laundry during the summer, washing motel sheets and occasionally driving a delivery truck around to those same motels. Tabby was taking care of the kids during her days, writing poems when they took their naps and working a full shift at Dunkin' Donuts after I came home from school. Our combined income was enough to pay the rent, buy groceries, and keep diapers on our infant son, but not enough to manage a phone. We let that go the way of the Texaco card. Too much temptation to call someone long distance. There was enough left over to occasionally buy books, neither of us could live without those, and to pay for my bad habits, beer and cigarettes, but very little beyond that. Certainly there wasn't money to pay finance charges for the privilege of carrying that convenient but ultimately dangerous rectangle of plastic. What leftover income we did have usually went for things like car repairs, doctor bills, or what Tabby and I called kid shit, toys, a secondhand playpen, a few of those maddening Richard Scarry books. And that little bit of extra often came from the short stories I was able to sell to men's magazines like Cavalier, Dude, and Adam. In those days, it was never about writing literature, and any discussion of my fiction's lasting value would have been as much of a luxury as that Texaco card. The stories, when they sold, they didn't always, were simply a welcome bit of found money. I viewed them as a series of piñatas I banged on, not with a stick, but my imagination. Sometimes they broke and showered down a few $100. Other times, they didn't. Luckily for me, and believe me when I say that I have led an extremely lucky life in more ways than this one, my work was also my joy. I was knocking myself out with most of those stories, having a blast. They came one after another, like the hits from the AM rock radio station that was always playing in the combination study and laundry room where I wrote them. I wrote them fast and hard, rarely looking back after the second rewrite, and it never crossed my mind to wonder where they were coming from, or how the structure of a good short story differed from the structure of a novel, or how one manages issues of character development, backstory, and time frame. I was flying entirely by the seat of my pants, running on nothing but intuition and a kid's self-confidence. All I cared about was that they were coming. That was all I had to care about. Certainly, it never occurred to me that writing short stories is a fragile craft, one that can be forgotten if it isn't used almost constantly. It didn't feel fragile to me then. Most of those stories felt like bulldozers. Many best-selling novelists in America don't write short stories. I doubt if it's a money issue. Financially successful writers don't need to think about that part of it. It might be that when the world of the full-time novelist shrinks to below, say, 70,000 words, a kind of creative claustrophobia sets in. Or maybe it's just that the knack of miniaturization gets lost along the way. There are lots of things in life that are like riding a bike, but writing short stories isn't one of them. You can forget how. During the late 80s and 90s, I wrote fewer and fewer stories, and the ones I did write were longer and longer, and there are a couple of the longer ones in this book. That was okay, but there were also short stories I wasn't writing because I had some novel or other to finish, and that wasn't so okay. I could feel those ideas in the back of my head, crying out to be written. Some eventually were, others, I'm sad to say, died and blew away like dust. Worst of all, there were stories I no longer knew how to write, and that was dismaying. I knew I could have written them in that laundry room on Tabby's little Olivetti portable, but as a much older man, even with my craft more honed and my tools, the Macintosh I'm writing on tonight, for instance, much more pricey, those stories were eluding me. I remember messing one up and thinking of an aging sword maker, looking helplessly at a fine Toledo blade and musing, I used to know how to make this stuff. Then one day, 3 or 4 years ago, I got a letter from Katrina Kennison, who edited the Best American Short Story series. She has since been succeeded by Heidi Pintler, to whom the book you were listening to is dedicated. Ms. Kennison asked if I'd be interested in editing the 2006 volume. I didn't need to sleep on it or even think it over on an afternoon walk. I said yes immediately, for all sorts of reasons, some even altruistic, but I would be a black liar indeed if I didn't admit self-interest played a part. I thought if I read enough short fiction, immersed myself in the best the American literary magazines had to offer, I might be able to recapture some of the effortlessness that had been slipping away. Not because I needed those checks, small but very welcome when you're just starting out, to buy a new muffler for a used car or a birthday present for my wife, but because I didn't see in losing my ability to write short stories as a fair exchange for a wallet load of credit cards. I read hundreds of stories during my year as guest editor, but I won't go into that here. If you're interested, buy the book and read the introduction. You'll also be treating yourself to 20 swell short stories, which is no poking the eye with a sharp stick. The important thing, as it affects the stories that follow, is that I got excited all over again, and I started writing stories again in the old way. I had hoped for that, but had hardly dared believe it would happen. The first of these new stories was Willa, which is also the first story in the book. Are these stories any good? I hope so. Will they help you pass a dull airplane flight or a long car trip if you're listening? I really hope so, because when that happens, it's kind of a magic spell. I loved writing these, I know that. And I hope you like listening to them, I know that too. I hope they take you away. And as long as I remember how to do that, I'll keep at it. Oh, And one more thing. I know some readers like to hear something about how or why certain stories came to be written. If you are one of those people, you'll find my liner notes here at the end. But if you go there before you listen to the stories themselves, shame on you. And now, let me get out of your way, but before I go, I want to thank you for coming. Would I still do what I do if you didn't? Yes, indeed I would, because it makes me happy when the words fall together and the picture comes and the make-believe people do things that delight me. But it's better with you, constant reader. Always better with you. Sarasota, Florida, February 25th, 2008.
Willa. Read by Holter Graham.
"You don't see what's right in front of your eyes," she'd said. But sometimes he did. He supposed he wasn't entirely undeserving of her scorn, but he wasn't entirely blind either. And as the dregs of sunset faded to bitter orange over the Wind River Range, David looked around the station and saw that Willa was gone. He told himself he wasn't sure, but that was only his head. His sinking stomach was sure enough. He went to find Lander, who liked her a bit, who called her spunky when Willa said Amtrak was full of shit for leaving them stranded like this. A lot of them didn't care for her at all. Stranded by Amtrak or not.
"It smells like wet crackers in here,"
Helen Palmer shouted at him as David walked past. She had found her way to the bench in the corner, as she always did.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.